Okay, so the next thing that we're going to be doing is we're going to look at some questions. Now, the first question here says, define the principal focus of a concave mirror. Now, go back to what we had discussed when we had defined the principal focus, the principal axis. We had defined that the answer to this is the principal focus of a concave mirror. Now, I don't want you to unnecessarily remember things. I want you to always imagine the ray diagram in your head and then build the definition from there. Now, what had I told you in case of the principal focus of a concave mirror? I had said that whenever, say, rays are coming from infinity, then they go like this and they meet at the focus. So what is happening? The rays that are coming from infinity are meeting, or what was the word we used? Converging. So we say that the principal focus of a concave mirror is the point. Where is the point lying? Is the point lying on the road? Where is the point lying? On the principal axis. So these are some things that you have to now keep in mind when you define that. As many scientific and factual details you can include in your definition, that much better. So your definition would form, your definition would sound even more technical. Okay, so on the principal axis, where all rays coming from infinity, what happens? They meet, or what is the word that we should use? Converge. Great. Now, although the question doesn't say it, what if I just add one part to the question? What if I just add one part to the question, that define it for a, define for convex mirror also. So, again, I don't want you to unnecessarily remember details. I want you to build it from what you know. So, convex mirror. Again, just think of rays coming from infinity. What happens? Ray comes like this. What happens? You draw the normal passing through. What happens? You draw the normal passing through the center of curvature. You draw your reflected ray passing through the focus. Similarly, one more ray coming from infinity, it seems to pass through the focus and seems to reflect. So what does it look like? That as if the rays, when we backtrace the rays, they seem to meet at the focus. So what does it look like? From the focus, the rays are going outwards. Like in case of a concave mirror, what happens? The rays seem to be coming inwards and meeting at the focus. But in case of a convex mirror, it seems like they're going outward from the focus. So from there, you build your definition that, oh, we've already written answer. So we don't need this here. We just say that the principal focus of a convex mirror is the point on the principal axis from where all rays, what is happening? That the rays that come from infinity, I'm just using the symbol, appear to, because they are not actually diverging from that point because we have made a dotted line, so it's imaginary. So appear to diverge. That's it. Next question. It says the radius of curvature of a spherical mirror. So we are given the radius of curvature as 20 centimeter, and what is its focal length? So whenever we are given a question like a numerical like this, we always write the things that are given to us. So what is given to us here? That the radius of curvature, which is denoted by R, is equal to 20 centimeter. Right. Now, what do we have to find? You should always write like this, given and to find. So it makes it very easy for you to finally find out, because you have all the information you're given in the question right here in front of you, and then you can easily use it to solve the question. So we have to find the focal length, or small f is equal to. So basically, what is the focal length? Here we're just given a spherical mirror. So it can be a convex mirror, it can be a concave mirror. So if I take the example of a concave mirror, what is the focal length in the concave mirror? This is the pole, this is the focus, this is the center of curvature. Again, I'm doing something that I have done a lot of times. If I make the sphere, this is the center of the sphere, right? So it doesn't look like this. So we should make the sphere look like this, okay? So that it looks like the C is the center of the sphere. Now, what is the distance between these two points? What is the any distance that is between the center and one point at a sphere or a circle? It is always the radius. So here it is a radius of curvature, because we are taking a spherical mirror. Okay, so that is basically a sphere that is in the form of a mirror from which the mirror has been cut. We have discussed this a lot of times. So what is the radius of curvature? Basically this distance from C to P. And this distance, because we call this point F or focus, the distance between F and P is called small f, that is the focal length. So what can we see? That the radius of curvature, we've studied this also, is 2 times the focal length, right? So if the focal length is given to us, okay, so the radius of curvature is 2 times the focal length. This is a very important relation that you always have to remember, and you can easily visualize this, because focal length we know lies right at the midpoint of the radius of curvature. So obviously midpoint, so 2 times the focal length makes the radius of curvature. Okay, so now what do we have to find? We are given the radius of curvature and we have to find the focal length. So if we use this equation, we know that F is equal to R by 2, and R is given to us as 20. So our F is 20 by 2, which is nothing but 10 centimeter. So there we have it. You've solved this numerical, that the focal length is 10 centimeter. Okay, moving on. Now the third question is, name a mirror that can give an erect and enlarged image of an object. So as soon as you hear erect, you might think, oh, convex mirror always gives an erect image. But look at the second part of this. Do you remember the size of the image that was formed by a convex mirror? Just try and remember. We only had 2 cases in case of a convex mirror. One where it was at infinity, and one where it was anywhere, where it was anywhere to the left side of the pole. So when it's at infinity, we know that it looks like it is diverging from the focus. Again, coming from infinity, looks like it is diverging from the focus. So it is formed at the image is formed at the focus, but look at the size of the image. What is the size? Can I draw any arrow here? Any size arrow? No, right? Because the image is point size. Second, if we look at the other case, in the case of a convex mirror, this is the F, this is the C, and somewhere around here. Okay, let's make it a little bit. So this is the size of the object. So one, if we take the ray parallel to the principal axis, it seems to diverge from the focus like this. Next, say we take obliquely incident, so it goes like this. And we backtrace it here. So again, correct, erect image is formed, but is it enlarged? No. So in case of a convex mirror, although it is erect. Yes, so one part of the question is being satisfied, but it is not enlarged. So our convex mirror is ruled out. It is not a convex mirror. Now, think back to a concave mirror. Do you remember most of the cases the concave mirror gave us a real and inverted image? But if you remember, there was one case that gave us an erect image. And that case, if you don't remember, then you need to practice your ray diagrams thoroughly, was when we kept the object between the focus and the pole. So here we have the focus, this is the pole. If we keep our object here, then one ray goes like this. This is our object AB, okay? One ray goes like this, passes through the focus, say obliquely incident the next ray, passes like this. Now, doesn't meet here because they're going in different directions, not parallel, but going in different directions. So what do? We retrace it behind the mirror and it meets somewhere here. So one, the first thing is ticked, that in case of a concave, is it forming an erect image? Erect means upright, that it is straight. Is the arrow straight or is the arrow like hanging from the ceiling? It's straight, right? And is it enlarged? Look at the size of the object arrow and look at the size of the image arrow. Is it bigger, the image arrow? Yes. So there we have the concave mirror is the mirror that gives an erect and enlarged image of an object. So if you are given this, in the answer you will write concave mirror gives an erect and enlarged image. Also, you have to write the case. So I'm not writing the full answer here, but you have to write the full answer. You write when, so you write concave mirror gives us an erect and enlarged image when the object is placed between F and P, that is the focus and the pole. That is the case in which you have to, that is the case in which you will get an erect and enlarged image. And for this case, just to make your answer perfect, draw the ray diagram also. Then no one would be able to tell you that there is something wrong with your answer. Okay, great. Moving on. Next question says, why do we prefer a convex mirror as a rear view mirror in vehicles? So now we've seen that a convex mirror is bulging out, right? So that is one thing. So what does bulging out mean? Bulging out says that it has a wider area of coverage. Like we discussed the example of the convex mirror being placed at a blind turn in any apartment or somewhere, so that the car coming from one end can't see the car coming from the other end because of the building. But in the convex mirror, because it is bulging out and it covers so much area, the driver of one car can easily see if another car is coming from that blind turn road. Okay, so the first thing, why do we prefer convex mirrors as rear view mirrors as, so the first point was a wider coverage. So even when you are driving and you look into the rear view mirror, you are able to see a lot of cars that are to one side. Or if you look into the other mirror, you would be able to see a lot of cars that are on the other side. So you can make a very informed decision. So you can make a very informed and smart decision as to when and where to make the turn or change your lane. Okay, so that is why it is important to have a convex mirror, because it has a wider coverage. The second thing is that it gives a smaller image. That is not as important as the other part of this, that it gives an erect image. This is another thing that we discussed in the last video, that what if you look into your rear view mirror and you see all the cars upside down, like they're hanging from the ceiling? Would you be able to make the right turn? You wouldn't even know where to go, right? So that is the second important point, that it gives a erect and upright image. Okay, it gives an erect image, so everything is visible to us straight and upright. And the second thing is it gives a diminished image. We did this when we did the ray diagram. So because it is diminished, it can capture many more. Like if you takes one parking space, you can only park one car there. But what if you decrease the size of the car? You can park a couple of cars there then, right? So that is the same logic that goes behind it. Because the size of the cars or the size of the image formed in the convex mirror is small, that is why it is able to cover a larger area, and that is why a larger number of cars are visible to us. So we can see where we are going and when to make which turn. Okay. So now, in this section, we have covered a lot of important topics. We have covered how image is formed in spherical mirrors. So first, we took some important things that we needed to know absolutely importantly for all ray diagrams. What were they? Some cases, we took four cases. We took one, when the ray is coming parallel to the principal axis. Two, when it is passing through the focus. Three, when it is passing through the center of curvature. And four, when it is obliquely incident to the principal axis. Now, these were the four cases that we then went forward and used when we did the ray diagrams for different spherical mirrors. So then we did it for spherical mirror, first concave mirror. We did slowly and slowly, we brought it closer to the mirror. You remember, first we kept it at infinity, then we kept it beyond C, then we kept it at C, then we kept it between C and F, then we kept it at F, and then we kept it between the pole and F. And we saw where the image was formed. We saw if the image was bigger or smaller or the same size as the object. And we saw the nature of the image. Was it real and inverted, or was it virtual and erect? Okay. Then we did it in case of a convex mirror, in which it was very easy. It made our life very easy. There were only two cases. Okay. And that is the thing that we have to remember, that in case of a convex mirror, there are only two cases. And in both of them, you get a virtual and an erect and a diminished image. Okay. So, and then we did some questions based on this. So now what I want you to do is, I want you to make the ray diagrams yourself. Make it using a scale, a compass and a protractor, and you would get to know exactly how these ray diagrams are drawn. Okay, students. Now in the next class, we're going to do the mirror formula and magnification. Okay. I hope you enjoyed this lecture. Thank you and take care.